Okay, welcome to Vodcast 3 of 3. This will be the last Vodcast of this unit. It's Chapter 9, Lesson 3, and this one is all about absolute dating. So far in this unit, Lesson 1, we talked about fossils. I think everyone's pretty confident with that, knows what's going on there. Lesson 2 was relative dating, and if you'll remember, relative ages or relative dating is when we figure out the age of something compared to something else. So you always have to have at least two things in order to compare them, and so you would say, you know, layer A is older than layer B or something to that effect. And so today we're talking about absolute dating, which is a little bit different, and we'll go ahead and get into that. Obviously, the first thing we're going to talk about is what is an absolute age. And so scientists use the term absolute age to mean the numerical age of a rock or an object. And this is important, okay? So examples would be, you know, if someone asks you how old you are, you may say 11 years old. If I ask you how old a rock is, you might say 200 million years old, okay? So these are all numerical, some number value. Okay, so these are going to be absolute ages. And today what we're really focusing on is how do we know these absolute ages? Now, as an introduction to that, we have to understand the concept of something called radioactivity. And most of you have heard of that before. We're just going to get into a little more detail on it today. So scientists have been able to determine the absolute ages of rocks and other objects since the beginning of about the 20th century when radioactivity was discovered. Now, radioactivity is the release of energy from an unstable atom. So let's look at that idea of radioactivity a little more closely in a second here. We also need to understand the concept of isotopes, which are atoms of the same element that have a different number of neutrons. Now, I know it's been a while, but you might remember that atoms are made up of three what we call subatomic particles. Okay, you have protons, you have neutrons, and electrons. Okay, those are the three subatomic particles. Now, what element you have is dependent upon the number of protons. Okay, that determines what element you have. So, okay, we've been talking a lot in class about carbon because carbon is used for something called radiocarbon dating. Now, carbon always has six protons. Okay, that does not change. If it's carbon, it has six protons because protons define what element you have. Now, it's possible though for carbon to have different amounts of elements. So, for example, if a carbon has seven neutrons. Okay, if carbon has seven neutrons, then you add these together to figure out its atomic mass. So that's 13. So we would call this carbon 13. Now, if the carbon atom has six protons, and it must, and it has eight neutrons, then that's going to be called carbon 14. Okay, carbon 14. And this is the one you've been hearing a lot about in class because it's the radioactive version. Okay, so stable isotopes don't change under normal conditions, but there are such things as unstable isotopes. So this image just kind of shows what we just talked about. All atoms of a specific element will always have the same number of protons. Okay, so these are all hydrogen. Okay, all of these pictures are hydrogen. Okay, the little orange dot represents the proton. Okay, so this is your proton in each case. So they all have one proton, so that means you have hydrogen because hydrogen always has one proton. The difference is, though, that this one has no neutrons, so this has an atomic mass of one. Okay. This one, which we call hydrogen 2, has an atomic mass of 2 because it has one neutron. And then the last one here has one proton, makes it a hydrogen, but two neutrons, which gives it an atomic mass of 3. So we call that hydrogen 3. Now, radioactive decay, and this is really where we start to get into the idea of being able to determine the ages of rocks, is the process by which an unstable element naturally changes into another element that is stable. So we just looked at an example with hydrogen. Okay, now you'll notice that it says that the hydrogen 3 here is actually unstable. Now because it's unstable, it's going to decay, and that means this element is radioactive. Now, the extra neutron decays and forms a proton, and in this process, a new stable element forms. So instead of hydrogen 3, we turn this into the neutron here is actually changed into a proton. So now we have two protons. Now, because of that, we've changed the element. Remember, when you change the number of protons, you change the element. So no longer do we have hydrogen. Okay, hydrogen is no longer. Now we have something called helium 3, which is a stable element. Now, when that change occurs, when the neutron decays, energy is released, and this is what we normally think of as radioactivity. That energy being released is what we consider dangerous in many circumstances. Now, what's interesting about this decay is that over long periods of time, it's actually a predictable rate at which this occurs. Now, the rate of decay is constant for any isotope, and it's measured in time units called half-lives. Okay. Now, this is a really important concept, and this is really why this is important to us when understanding the age of the Earth. Now, an isotope's half-life is the time required for one half of the parent isotopes, what we call parent, which would be the same as original isotopes, to decay into what we call daughter isotopes. Okay. Now, half-lives of radioactive isotopes range from a few microseconds, very small numbers, to billions of years. And it's these larger ones that we really use for finding the age of rocks and the age of the Earth. Now, this is kind of a graph that's going to illustrate to you and explain what half-life is. Okay, so we're going to look at this a little more closely. Now, up at the top here, before you'll notice on the x-axis, we have the number of half-lives. Okay, so you have zero half-lives, one, two, three, up to five. On the left-hand side, where the y-axis is, we have the amount of material. Now, these are percentages over here, okay? These are the percentage of original material that we have. Now, you'll see at step one here, you have an object that contains 100% of the parent, which is going to be represented by kind of these gold bars here. Okay, which means basically whatever you have at the beginning is all that you have. It doesn't matter if you start with 10 grams, 100 grams, 1,000 grams, 1,000,000 grams. It doesn't matter. You have all of what you have. You have 100%. And really what we're dealing with mostly is ratios. Now, after you go through one half-life, what happens is you lose half of the original material. And so you'll see it after one half-life. If you look here, after one half-life, right? Look what we have. We've reduced the amount of original, or what we call parent, okay, original material, in half. And now we have 50% what we call parent, original material, and 50% what we call daughter. Now that just means material that's created or comes from the original material. Okay, so now we're at 50-50. Now, after two half-life cycles, okay, if we look here, what happens is you take the remaining parent. Now think about what you had at the beginning, right? We had 100% of the material, okay? Now after two half-lives, what did we have left? Well, we had 50%, okay? Now, again, we're going to go through a half-life, and that means you take half of what you have left. Now we only have half left, 50% left. So what's half of half? Well, 25%, and that's what you see here, right? There are eight bars, two of which are the original material, and so therefore we have 25% left. Now that means 75%, the majority, is now daughter material. Okay, now after three half-lives, again, we take what's left and we reduce that by half, and so we're at 12.5% of the original material and 87.5% of the daughter. Now, after we go past that, we get into pretty small numbers, right? You're talking about 6.25% and then 3.125%. You get into really small values, okay? So normally, you know, we're only going to be dealing with in class, you know, maybe one through five half-lives, okay? And this is just an image. You certainly do not need to memorize these. This is just to show you kind of what the actual half-lives are. A lot of people want to know, well, what's a real example? And these are some real examples that you see here. And so on the left-hand side, you have the parent isotope. These are the radioactive elements. So uranium-235, potassium-40, uranium-238. These are all radioactive elements. In the middle, you have the half-life, how long it takes for half of the material to decay, and then the daughter product. So this is what's left over. This over here is going to be something that's stable, right? Over here, you have your, I'm going to put R for radioactive. This is unstable, radioactive. It decays in this amount of time, that's the half-life, into this stable material. Okay, so again, you don't have to actually know this by heart. You don't have to memorize it. You just have to really kind of understand what it is. And it's just to show you some useful isotopes that we use for dating rocks. So let's try, we're going to do two different examples to make sure you really understand how to do this, okay? So this says uranium-235 decays to lead-207 with a half-life of 704 million years. What percentage of uranium-235 is left after three half-life cycles? And then there's a secondary question which says, how long would this take? So you look at your question and you have U-235 and that decays to lead, which is the symbol PB207. And it takes 704 million years for one half-life. Okay? So the question wants to know what percentage is left after three half-life cycles. Now, we don't even really need any of this information in order to solve the first part. Okay? All you have to know is that after zero half-lives, okay, I'm going to put P for parent and then D for daughter. Okay? After zero half-lives, you're going to have 100%. You start with 100% and you have no daughter, which would be zero. Okay? After one half-life, you have half of what was originally there, which would be 50%. Now, because you don't have, you have 50% turned into from parent, you've turned that in now to daughter material. Okay, these numbers, notice that parent and daughter will always add up to 100. Now, after two half-lives, we have half of what was left, half of 50, which is 25. And remember, we want this to add up to 100, so that would be 75% daughter. And then after three half-lives, we're going to have half of 25, which would be 12.5. And then, of course, 87.5% daughter. Okay? Now, the question is, how much of the what percentage of the uranium-235 is left after three half-life cycles? So, uranium-235 was the parent. So, if we look down after three half-life cycles, it's 12.5%. All right? Now, the question is, how long would this take? All right? Now, think back. The half-life is 704 million years. So, for one half-life, it takes 704 million years. For the second half-life, it takes another 704 million years. For the third half-life, it takes, you guessed it, another 704 million years. So what does this look like? Well, we can add these together, or this is a simple multiplication. 704 million times 3. Okay, that's a 3. All right. Now, what I want you to do is your homework tonight is to email me the answer to this question, okay? Please put the subject, because if you don't email me with a subject, then it gets kicked into my junk folder, and I've been having to pick a bunch of messages out of there. Please give me the subject, half-life, okay? And the body of the email should just be the answer to this, 704 million times 3. Whatever that is, please email that to me, and that'll be your homework, okay? So let's do one more practice problem. Same idea here. We have potassium-40 decaying to argon-40 with a half-life of 1.25 billion years. You begin with 500 grams of potassium-40. How much is left after 3.75 billion years? Now, it's the same type of problem. We're just working kind of in a different order. Now, I like to always write out my information, okay? So I'm going to say potassium, which is actually K-40, decays to argon-40. And it takes 1.25 billion years. Okay? Now I'm starting with 500 grams of potassium 40. And I want to know how much is left after 3.75 billion years. Okay? Now there's a couple different ways you can approach this. I think the easiest is just to look at, well, first of all, how many half-lives have I gone through in 3.75 billion years? So if you look at that, it might be automatically apparent to you that after one half-life, it's 1.25 billion years. After two half-lives, it's twice this length, which would be 2.5 billion years. After three, well, we've got our answer there, 3.75 billion years. So we know it took three half-lives to reach that amount of time. Okay, so three half-lives occur in 3.75 billion years. Now all we have to do is figure out, well, what percentage of this material is going to be left after three half-lives? Now, there's two different ways to do it. You can do it in percentages, or you can just take the half of this three different times. So I'm going to do it that way so you can see it done a little bit differently. So we have 500 grams of original material. Now, we divide that by two. Okay, or multiply by a half, divide by 2, and we get 250 grams. That's one half-life. That's the first one. Now, after two half-lives, we take what's left, 250, and then we divide that by 2 also. Okay, and we get 125. Okay, 125 grams. Now, after three half-lives, we take what we have left, 125 grams, divide that by 2, equals 62.5, okay? So just another way that you can use this information, half-life information, to calculate either how much is left or how long or how old something is. So scientists do these types of calculations all the time to figure out how old the Earth is. So let's use that information and figure out, well, how old is the Earth, okay? Now, we use uranium-235 because it's often trapped in minerals of igneous rocks. That's a good place to look for this information, is a lot of times in igneous rocks. The half-life of uranium is about 704 million years, which is useful for rocks that are very old. Now, if we look at something like carbon, a lot of people will say, well, how do we know how old the Earth is? And someone will say carbon dating or radiocarbon dating. And really, that's only useful for measuring things that are, first of all, organic. And really, it's only good for things that are about 50,000 years old, up to 50,000 years old. Now, that sounds like a long time, but we're going to see that the Earth is, you know, actually many billions of years old. So we don't really use carbon dating unless we're talking about organisms that lived, you know, less than 50,000 years ago. Really, what we're using for rocks are things like uranium-235 that has a much larger half-life. So based on that, the oldest known rock formation that we have dated or found the age of is estimated between about 4.03 billion and 4.28 billion years old. That's about the oldest rocks. Based on some other evidence that we have, finding the age of rocks from the moon and different meteorites that we think coincide with the formation of the Earth, we've determined that the Earth is about 4.54 billion years old. That's the best approximation that we have for the age of the Earth right now, 4.54 billion years old, which is pretty old. So that ends our unit vodcast. We will be wrapping up the unit next time I see you in class. Monday is the last day for the unit. Hope you enjoyed the vodcast. Hope this makes a little more sense to you now. Hope everything's a little more clear. I know some people have been questioning about this information. If you have questions, of course, as always, ask me in class, and I will see you then.